Welcome to the Money Collective podcast. We're here to uplift your financial well-being. Your hosts are me, Mel Pierce, and Darlene New. We are the co-founders of the Money Collective, and together we have over 50 years of finance and banking experience. We provide the tools, information, and guidance to better understand your money and feel confident making money decisions. Welcome to episode one, season one of the Uplifting Financial Wellbeing podcast by the Money Collective.
Yeah, and I'm Darlene.
Hi, Darlene.
And
I'm Mel.
Yeah, Mel's my we're the co-founders of the Money Collective.
Yeah, so the Money Collective is a business that we've been running for 4 years. And we're just super excited to get started on our very first podcast. So today's topic is going to be about why we're doing this, what we're all about, so you can learn about what we're passionate about and get to know us.
Yeah, today. Exactly. And so to begin with, we're going to add a little, we're going to call it our truth.
Yes.
That we kick off each podcast with.
Yes.
And
so it's a weekly truth.
Yep.
And it's a true story from us. So I'm going to share one, you're going to share one.
We are. And before we hop into the topic today.
Okay, because it's important to hear what we truly think about money is the whole point.
It is. And, you know, and it's really never about money. I'm going to put that out there now. It's really about our lives and our vulnerabilities. So they're very connected.
Yeah. Alrighty. So we've got a team of eight and we get together this is my truth, jumping straight in.
Great.
And every Tuesday we eat lunch together. So we put the time aside and we talk about our financial well-being. So we don't do that every single Tuesday. We certainly have lunch together and talk about something very relevant every single Tuesday. And we like to very regularly talk about our own financial well-being. Our well-being is how we feel about our money.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and we hold each other accountable in these meetings as well. And so I've been saying over the last few months about what I wanted to be doing. So I really wanted to be tracking and categorizing my expenses and, you know, basically doing a review of all my expenses to make sure that all my accounts are set up and I know where my money's going. And I have not been doing it, right? I just haven't been doing it. And I felt really bad. So I got to the meeting this week and I'm driving to work and I'm thinking, I'm going to lie. I'm going to say that I've done it.
Yep.
That was my tact, yep. Right? And I'm going to go and just say, at least I've gotten started on doing my numbers.
Yep.
Anyway, I sat down in front of everyone and there's no way that I could do that. And I just said, I was going to lie to you all. I've done my numbers and I just couldn't do it. Like I just said, I was going to lie.
No.
And the girls and the team really held me accountable and basically helped me like so much with compassion.
Mm.
And making me feel like it's hard for everyone doing this.
It is hard for everyone. Money is hard for everybody. And nobody I know is perfect at it.
Like looking at my numbers, there's a block there. Why don't I want to be looking at my numbers?
Yeah.
I talk about this all day, every day.
Mm-hmm. With the work we do. And, addressing it ourselves, we all have those barriers. We all want to make it sound better than what it is. Yeah, having a good support group around you is pretty cool. Yeah.
And they just made me feel like it was okay. Like that it's hard, it's all good. And Angela in our team, she showed me later, she goes, Mel, I'm going to give you some inspo. This is my spreadsheet, what I've been doing. And it did. It was like massive inspiration. So if I didn't have all of you around me, then I wouldn't do it and I would ignore it. That's my innate personality.
Mm-hmm.
I have that fear. So I'm just so thankful for everybody. And I did the work. So I've been putting it off for months and months and I did it. So it's a good news story for me this week. Mm. Don't know if it's always going to be.
No.
But I, from turning it around from lying to doing the work to feeling awesome and feeling I had to hide and now sharing.
Yeah.
So thank you, team. Love you, girls.
Look, there's so many key messages out of that. And as we continue through some podcasts, and hopefully we get some listeners. We'll continue to talk about, you know, the messages. But out of that, I really heard, gosh, you need, you know, you need a good group and a supportive group around you to help you, you know, continually work on your own story.
So yeah, that's very it.
Cool. So my truth, my very first truth, is I don't have an outcome for it yet. We talk about money stories in the work that we do, and I've actually gone quite deep going into my money story of late. And I do think, you know, it happens for a reason. You know, sometimes we know part of it, but actually I've been digging a bit deeper because I feel like that I've had a ceiling that I can't break through, and feel like I haven't, my voice isn't worthy of listening to. So we're going to talk about this shortly in the topic of the day and why we're doing this podcast. But so I decided that I would start writing down my money story. And so I've partly been doing that, and it's been really triggering for me. And I grew up in a family that really talked a lot about money, and money was a center of the daily conversations. So I always felt I had to do well, what was perceived as well, and we'll get into that too, because there is no right or wrong with money. Always perceived I had to be really good with money, and to show that I, you know, lived up to the family expectation maybe. But unpacking that story, actually working through all the causes and effects that's caused me through, and what I've done in life that is very connected to that belief and that story, and really trying to work through letting some of that go. So as you get to know us a bit more, I'll unpack that further, I'm sure.
Yeah, no, that's been so powerful, and it's led you to make some really big decisions and come to massive realizations. Which, even though we've been talking about this for 4 years, our money story, why it's important, it's funny how you get another goodie.
Yeah.
If you're prepared to do the work, and it comes at unexpected times.
Yeah. It is the work that keeps on giving. That is for sure. And it's never-ending work. You can't just, you know, set up your budget and system and follow it and think that's your money sorted and for life. It is much more holistic and bigger than that.
It certainly is.
It's an ongoing, I think it's ongoing growth. And yeah, if you're willing to really
put the work
in, be honest with it.
That's it. And keep going with it. So that brings us to today's topic. The main point for today's podcast is to tell you why we started the podcast, what we're all about. So it's a scary thing for us.
Very.
I think that we've always, when we started this business 4 years ago, we really knew that we needed to connect with people and our community on a wider scale. But why has it taken us 4 years to get here? Some of that work that you mentioned, and we're kind of on that journey together.
Yeah.
And it's good to do it with somebody, that's for sure.
I'm very grateful. Gosh, if I hadn't met the lovely Mel, and that's a story for another day. I don't think I'd be anywhere, you know, near this path of how life-changing this is.
Yeah. So we're now ready to turn the microphone on and the cameras on and to share our experiences, because we've been in finance for 50 years, right? So, and it's a very male-dominated
environment. Very masculine, right?
Finance is masculine, full stop. The way we talk about it, how we engage in products, how the system's built. And to be in that our entire adult lives. How old were you when you started?
I joined a local bank when I was 16 years old, and I'm 52. Whatever that math is.
And I didn't finish year 12, and my dad was a mortgage broker. He was a career banker, and he said, if you're not going to go to school, then get a real job or work for me. I'm like, I don't want a real job. I'll work for you. And so he, was a mortgage broker in Launceston. I did that when, I don't know, I was 17 or 18, and I'm 40. So
yeah,
it's been a few years.
Yeah. And it's a really key point. So in finance, it is predominantly male dominated. So Mel and I, you know, coming together, definitely think, you know, is a bigger reason than us. And we have been women, female, in this industry trying to push through for that period of time.
We have. And yeah, it has been a push. Like, we're literally pushing. pushing. But, you know, we don't even know where we're doing it.
No, not at all.
No.
Only, over recent years.
And I think, like, our, like, the environment and our society is starting to understand that, and it's made it easier for us to unpack because... Yeah. As a community, we're getting to this point of understanding how hard or what we're up against as women.
Yeah, exactly. And you don't know, and you become so conditioned in just going to work every day and how it's done and not, you know, critically thinking about, you know, maybe even those impacts it has on you over time. But yeah, but what we know our stuff. I'm going to put that out there right now. We know a lot about finance. We want to bring something very different to the market, and that's what we're already doing. We'll talk about that, but we want to grow that and scale that so people can think differently about money.
That's it.
That's it. Yeah. Exactly.
Because, well, first of all, do you want to talk about how we are currently thinking about money?
Mm.
So, like, the traditional ways. So, like, I always explain it as that barbecue conversation, you know, you're with groups of friends and people are talking about what they do with their money and how it's working or not working.
Mm.
And they're really talking on that product level, like, of and what they're investing in and how they're doing it, or like that real tangible, like the stuff.
It's
like
very cold.
How much their house is worth, or the stats and the figures and the... and then we think,
how my investment's doing, or you know, everyone big notes themselves too at the barbecue. Can I say, like, who actually says I'm really struggling with money and I need help? Who says that?
Yes, or if you do that, then there's a power play sometimes that comes into effect. Whereas that vulnerability is so hard to come by.
Yeah, honesty and vulnerability.
So we do. We take, you know, data and stats. How much do we love data and stats?
Oh, I do. Mel, maybe not so much, but I do.
I know they're important. But, like, we, from the groups of people that we're working in, and also the research that's done by research bodies in Australia, is saying that people aren't feeling good about their money. They don't have optimism for their future when it comes to money. So if, like, the most recent group of people that we took data off, and they were executives, only 6% of them felt good about their money, and they're higher income earners.
Yeah.
But we know that it doesn't matter how much money you're earning, we're all feeling a very similar way about our money. Mm. Whether it's not just the people on the low incomes, it is definitely middle Australia and higher income earners are feeling not great.
Definitely. Very, very few people think they're good with money.
Internally.
Internally. Yes. They may say something different, but we find through, we do coaching one-on-one with people, and a lot of the time it can start there, but then when you unpack really what's going on.
Because we can see on the surface all the things they've got, the holiday house and the house and the cars and the kids and the education, it's all happening. Yeah. But what stress does that really cause us?
That's right. I need a bigger, you know, more accountable job that might take me away for more hours, and I say I want it, but do I really?
Because I need to keep up with what I've got.
Keep up with the Joneses. I need
to keep up with the Joneses and keep up with what I've got.
Mm-hmm.
Like, when we're overcommitted, how do we stay overcommitted without changing our life?
Because social comparison, right? We want to keep up with what we think we need to look like, rather than really, you know, staying in our own lane.
We don't
being
know how to
truly
stay
honest
in our own lane.
And vulnerable, and running our own race.
So that's what the data shows us, that if we don't have our own goals and aspirations, we're not very clear on our own values in life and that race that we want to be running for ourselves. Like, there's nobody else in our race. It's only us, maybe your immediate family,
and what's important to you. So knowing what's important in your life is important, obviously, to creating that vision for ourselves. But if that's not strong, or we don't hold on to it or we let it go, then we start this social comparison. I start looking at what Darlene has. I start looking at what car you're driving, what your home looks like, what you're doing on the weekends.
The material things.
What we see on the surface. And obviously marketing's really good at making us buy stuff too. Oh,
it's in our face all the time, right? Yeah. But the studies and financial well-being, it's definitely the number one thing that I hear from people all the time is I'm bad about money. And, you know, I put it out there. Who thinks about that in their own mind?
I'm so bad with
all
money.
The time.
Gee.
They might not say it out loud, or they might, but
yep.
It's definitely the most common thing that we hear. And, you know, we want to help change that feeling, that society and that thinking. That's
absolutely
what we're about. Yeah. At a broader scale, you can start with your own money and understanding it and how it does, and then you feel better about it. But then it's actually breaking down that stigma of money and be courageous in all your environments, to say you've got this.
Yeah. Right? I think too, because like emotions come into play with money, right? Mm. So we get very emotional about money. And so what I talked about in my truth earlier was that fear that I have and shame that I hold because I'm not doing it well enough and I'm too scared to look. And I don't want to share. Yeah. So we have those emotions all the time around money. Mm,
mm-hmm.
And then we get overwhelmed with it and we don't know how to move forward.
Yeah, exactly. And women, again, it's that masculine and feminine. Because Mel's talking about the feeling of money and women really bring that, you know, more element. So. But haven't we all need to be more in touch with that feeling and be honest and truthful and peel back the onion layers and really talk about how it's impacting our lives.
Because the fear and the shame and the guilt is what's holding me back. It's what's holding everyone back. Those emotions are stopping us from moving forward. So when we say we're no good with money, it's easy just to stop there and close ourselves off to like the next step that we should be taking. So that's why accountability is so good and having people around you. So that's what we want to provide in this podcast, is to say, hey, we've got you. How you're feeling is normal.
Yeah, I think that's
we're all feeling the same thing.
That's right. And there's that's the big, you know, the big change that we need to make. And you can do that by addressing your behaviors, as we've talked about. But there's lots of practical components and there's lots of things out there. And we'll certainly talk about that as well. You know, we have a program that takes you through the practical. But the practical things help you then address really the underlying, what's really going on.
Yeah.
To make change.
That's right. So there's that emotional side to your money, but then there's the absolutely practical side to money, which is what we're used to. So that is what, when we think about money, it's like, well, how are you budgeting? How are your accounts set up? All of that stuff, which is super important. Mm. Super important. Mm-hmm. But we get fixated there. But what's stopping us from getting there is those emotions that we have. So we need to just acknowledge them, get people around us who are supporting us and be able to step into doing the work, because the work is important. Mm. And what you're going to hear us talk about is knowing your number.
Oh, yes.
What is your number? Okay, this is going to be if we can impart one thing in every single podcast.
Know your number. And what does that mean, Mel?
Well, what is your number? I'm sure we're going to do a whole podcast on knowing your number. But essentially, your number is the amount of money you've got left over after you've done all your spending. So you have your money come in and then you do all your spending. And your spending is your mandatory living expenses that keep life going.
Yes.
That you have to spend on. So life can't keep going if you don't make those expenses happen.
Mm-hmm.
And then your everyday living, or your fun money type stuff. So what are we doing? Every coffee that we buy, our going out, eating out.
Mm.
Fun life. And then how much is left over after we do our normal stuff, you know? Because that's what we've got to play with, to make decisions with, to impact our financial future.
That's it. And you can do spend some of it for now, some of it in the longer term. Like if you save for a rainy day, then you've got choice later. Yeah, so it really is. Knowing your number is everything, because that's how you can plan for what you do with it. Yeah, which buys you choice.
And like we can look at the number. So my number annually, do you know what your number is? So mine's about $22,000. Yep. Okay.
Mine's 30.
Okay. But I know that if I fuck up a little bit, I don't know if you have to beep that out, then I'm not going to get to 22,000.
Yeah.
Like what I do every single day. So knowing those underlying numbers and how I'm behaving is also super important. And that's where my account structures make sense, yeah, and understanding what my spending behaviors are, my money personality. These are all podcast people.
Yeah.
We'll break it all down for you.
That's it.
But like all of that is going to determine whether, because I can do a spreadsheet now, it says I'm going to have 22,000, but what I do every single day will determine whether I've got that or not.
Exactly. Yeah. So, but knowing what that number is and then, you know, measuring it, tracking it, doing all those things. Am I meeting it? Is it realistic? Do I need to change it? What does that mean to my goal? Is really important. But you cannot do it unless you know your number. And, you know, some people's number is not going to be positive.
No.
You know, it's...
It could be break even or negative.
It could be. But it's a really good starting point to understand what actions you would take next. No matter what your number is.
That's
whether
right.
It's negative, positive, nothing, you know. Because it's a way to start evaluating what's where you are
going on and what every day, what you need to do.
Yeah.
And what levers have you got around you. So it's really about understanding that broad picture of your finances. It's way more than just your bank account. It's who the people are you've got around you, what supports are there. Oh my gosh, there's so much in this. What your assets and liabilities are.
So but to start with, understanding your number, and it becomes a very powerful decision point that you can actually start to address what it is and how it works for you.
Yep.
No matter what it is, positive, negative. Yep. And that's a first step to financial well-being, because you need to understand your number.
Yeah.
Can't stress enough. Understand your number. If you don't understand your number, do an exercise, grab a spreadsheet, income minus expenses, net income minus expenses.
Net income, what's net income?
Net income is what actually goes into your bank account each pay. If you're, you know,
have a job, PAYG, get a pay job.
Yep. In self-employed is a little bit different because you have to put aside some tax, but it's what's left over your net income to live on. Less those personal expenses.
Yeah. Awesome. So just for today's podcast, is there anything else about us, Darlene?
That I'd like to say.
That we'd like to say to the world?
Yeah. Look, this is how we roll. So we are very excited to start the podcast and really unpack the stigma around money, but also give value to our audience of, you know, things we can do and how we can really uplift our financial well-being.
Yep.
So,
and I can promise everybody that you're only going to get real Mel and Darlene, right?
That's really great. Mel and I, what you hear today is how we are every day with all the people around us, our family, our friends, our you know, a team at work,
our clients,
everybody,
the CEOs of big banks will tell you what we think.
That's right. We are definitely not your corporate attire, you know,
and the stiff, but we're very conscious about this, and it's important that we're like this, because this is the problem with money, about the pretenses. You're just not going to get them from us, and no judgment either.
Yeah, that's a really good one. So there is no judgment around money. So to break that down, money is just a means to do what we want to do or not. That is it.
And the numbers are the numbers. Yeah. That's right. And so when we dig down, you might be super scared to look at your numbers, but like people like us, they're just numbers.
Yeah.
And we'll help you with a way forward and through.
Yeah.
That's the idea.
I think so too. So, walk away. That is, you know, something yeah, that we will definitely bring. And also, I'd say we're really walking into our own courage and being more courageous, even, you know, with working for people, because the hard questions need to be asked. They need to be addressed. We can't just assume everything about it, you know, that works around us is the way it should be, because it's not. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we want to make change for good.
We do.
Yeah. Yeah. So the last thing we'd like to leave you with is a segment about a question, a thought-provoking question, Mel.
Yes.
That we can leave the audience to have a think about, and we would really...
Do we want it before we do that?
Yes, I've forgotten the step.
We have.
I'll do this.
So, before we jump in and actually wind up, we want to tackle a question from the audience every single week. So a question that you have before we... But we are also going to leave you with a thought-provoking question at
come
the
back
end
to that
as well. But a question from you, we would love to answer weekly. So, we would like to start receiving those. But in the meantime, we have just come with our own question, and it's a question that we get asked all the time, right?
Mm.
So,
mm-hmm.
when we say what we do,
yep,
we've given you the long version. But when we say, what we do with financial well-being, so often people say, oh my gosh, that is so good. I need that. And you need to tell my partner how to stop spending money. How can I make my partner stop spending money, darling?
Oh my gosh, Mel. How triggering is that? So,
not me, but I've got it all under control, okay?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
I'm good.
Yeah.
But they...
Yep. So we see more often than not in those circumstances when we work with people, it's, I would say, never the case. I don't think there's one, that's never the reason people's financial well-being is where it is. It's just not even relevant. There you go to that. That would be my answer to that question. Yeah. You just need to understand your numbers and... You know, understand money personalities we haven't talked about yet, but understand and all things about your money. So your relationship with money individually, so that's your money story, your values, your partner would have different personalities and values and stories. So understanding a bit about them would be really helpful.
Because the communication is the issue, right? Okay, so we make, because there's judgment going on when this happens.
Yeah.
So somebody's saying, I'm good, you're bad. You need to fix it. So no wonder somebody's feeling bad in this relationship and thinks that they're no good about with money,
definitely.
Right? Because I'm good, you're bad, I'm managing this.
And you're probably telling
get
that
your
person.
Shit together, okay? Right? So is that encouraging? So what you're saying is understand where they're coming from, because there's things and issues going on beyond this communication, which is hindering this perpetuation of behavior.
Totally.
And also, can I say that when this happens, that the person who's saying this usually doesn't know the numbers and cannot say how much is being spent other than it's way too much.
That's right. They wouldn't be able to give you their number.
And often they are doing more of the spending. So when we go, okay then, let's dig into this a little bit more.
Yes.
And there's some massive purchases going on over here and this person is just being shamed.
Yep. Absolutely. It you've got to understand, and really that's the beginning of understanding financial well-being, is understand how you behave with money, the why, which is your money story and the stories that you're telling yourself every single day.
Your beliefs,
your values, and really, Mel's hit the nail on the head, is communication, right? It's just actually understanding and listening to each other. I feel like sometimes we're counsellors, but really it is understanding all perspectives and how our unit, if you want to call it that,
works
together with money.
Or not.
And what needs to change, maybe that's from doing those exercises.
And being kind and considerate and just stepping back a little bit, circling out and just seeing, you know, what's going on.
Yeah.
The other thing is that these things don't change overnight. So if you feel like there's fundamental problems, there probably is, more than what you know. And we know that money causes breakdowns in relationships. So it's a
very
really
high reason for relationship breakdown.
Piece yeah. of work to do. And we've dedicated our whole entire lives to it.
Yeah.
Other than we also care for our families and children and feed them yeah, and pick them up from places. Right. We do those things too.
Well, the other thing, and you know, we'll talk about this a lot too, what it does, if you're talking like that with your partner, right, or in your family environment, and you've got children, for example, what message are you giving to your children about money? So I'd really like to think about that question. That's a thought-provoking question, not today's that we have, but for another time. Because it's really important to think about what you want to embed, you know, what messages or, you know, that you want to, around money that you want to leave with your children and their future life.
They're absorbing everything.
They are. And our money stories come from our life so far, mm-hmm. and the majority of that is how we grew up with our families with money.
Yeah.
So we need to change the messaging and how we behave with money in our households and talk about money, if nothing else, for our young people around
That's right.
us.
Yeah.
So that they can be different with money and don't feel and fear it and think they're
bad.
You know, silly and bad. Yeah.
Yeah. And the only other way to do that, so it's having that care and consideration, it's also knowing your numbers as well, too, mm-hmm. being informed in a relationship. So it's not one person's responsibility mm-hmm. to know numbers. To really get this working is for both people to know the numbers. Mm-hmm. And this is the number that we were talking about. What is the number? Do you both know it? Do you know how you're getting there and where you're going? So that's the type of conversation that needs to be happening. And there is no quick fix to that question of how do I stop my partner spending money?
So if you just stop saying that question.
Yes.
Don't say that anymore and actually say, well, why am I asking the question? And actually go back and do the work.
Yes. Love it. Awesome. So let's wrap up today. And our last question that we want to leave you
the
with.
The thought-provoking one.
Yes.
Okay, I've written it down. So, yeah, do you, it's around gender pay gap, yeah. right? So,
do you have a story that's linked to the gender pay gap? So, do you hold on to a story about this gender pay gap? We know what that is. It means that females end up and retire with less money and are paid less, have less superannuation. But it's generally that there's a disparity in pay and wages for women. But do you have a story for that personally? Is there a woman close to you that you have a story that is impacting your life around the gender pay gap?
Yeah, we'd love to hear your questions or your stories about that. And then, next time we'll talk about the gender pay gap.
Yeah, break it down. Awesome. So we'll leave you with that thought. Thanks so much for joining us on our very first podcast, episode one. I don't know, it might get looser after this, but we had fun. I had fun today.
I did too. I can't, I'm really looking forward. Just to, you know, keep talking. Mel and I love to talk. We love a conversation. So please join it with us.
Yep. All right. Thanks for joining us. We'll talk to you next time.
See ya. At The Money Collective, we provide financial wellbeing premium coaching, mortgage broking and workplace financial wellbeing programs, which we couldn't do without the seamless support of our fabulous team.
If you'd like to find out more, head to themoneycollective.com.au or our socials to take action and engage our services. In our Facebook group, join the conversation and help us break down the taboo around money.
All content in this podcast is for educational purposes only and is general in nature. For tailored personal advice, please seek out a professional.